In 1932, Manchuria, long controlled by the Chinese, passed into Japanese hands. It was renamed Manchukuo, which in Japanese means Manchuria land. The last boy emperor of the Qing dynasty, Puyi, was installed as regent of a puppet government established by the Japanese. Puyi carried out Japanese policy in the newly declared independent state. The Japanese Kwantung Army ostensibly protected Japanese interests, but in fact made the independence of Manchukuo a blatant fiction. Although the Chinese did not resist, the forces of future conflict had been unleashed. By March 1933, the forces of war were set in motion. The Japanese military had seized control of foreign policy. Japan had resigned from the League of Nations. The system of collective security, of treaties outlawing war, and of disarmament had all but collapsed. China was a vacuum in fragmented disarray, sucking in the expansionist Japanese till it was too late for them to turn back. While Europe was dominated by individuals, the Far East seemed to be dominated by powerful forces, forces that appeared to be out of control. The Lytton Commission toured Manchuria following the invasion on a fact-finding mission launched by the League of Nations. The Lytton Report called for an autonomous Manchuria and condemned Japanese aggression. Japan objected.
The adoption of this report would give the impression to the Chinese that they had been exonerated from all responsibility, that they could continue to defy Japan with impunity. It would serve further to embitter the feelings of the Japanese and Chinese peoples. I ask you not to adopt this report for the sake of peace in the Far East and for the sake of peace throughout the world.
The report condemning Japan was unanimously adopted.
Le rapport est adopté à l'unanimité.
Japan, however, finds it impossible to accept the report adopted by the Assembly.
The Japanese delegation walked out and Japan resigned from the League of Nations. It was a clear sign that moderates had lost control of Japan's foreign policy.
Now, one is always struck by the fact that during the 1920s, the civilian governments of Japan, the parliamentary governments, were pretty well in control and dictated foreign policy as well as other things. And then, beginning with the Manchurian incident in 1931, the military simply took over foreign policy, determined what it was to be, and you had a dual government. And from there on, you have the army making foreign policy, and the poor civilian government sort of following behind, trying to justify it, you know, argue for it, even though it didn't believe in it itself. Now, they could have controlled it, perhaps, by their control of the budget, by simply stopping giving money to the military for purposes of expansionism. They didn't dare. The whole tenor of Japan, of attitudes in Japan, had gotten to the point where they felt that if they tried to cut the army off at the ankles in that way by not voting it its budget, maybe you'd have a coup d'etat.
In February 1936, there was a coup d'etat, and the public funerals of assassinated moderate cabinet members plunged Japan into a state of shock. Some 1,500 young army officers and soldiers had revolted, taking over the War Office, the Prime Minister's residence, and the Diet or Parliament building. The attack was aimed at opponents of the army's expansionist plans in China. Although the coup d'etat failed, influential opposition to the military had been eliminated. The victims, all moderate politicians, included Finance Minister Takahashi, General Watanabe, the new Inspector General of Military Education, and former Prime Minister Admiral Viscount Sato. Prime Minister Okata barely escaped with his life. Although the rebellion was put down by the Emperor and loyal troops, military extremists now dominated foreign affairs and pushed for a more aggressive China policy. As Japan mourned the deaths of her elder statesmen, young Turks in the army maneuvered behind the scenes. In January 1937, Prince Kanoi became Prime Minister. A moderate, he advocated expansion, but through peaceful means. But even Kanoi could not control the military, which soon reinforced its army in China with fresh troops and supplies. Japan's official policy was called the Greater East Asia Co-Prosperity Sphere, which simply meant tightening up the economic and political and military ties with China. Japan clearly intended to dominate the Far East, and it was inevitable that clashes would occur between Japanese and Chinese forces.
Neither side wanted war, but they drifted into it as though pulled by a riptide. Japan was drawn deeper and deeper into China, into the endless quagmire of Chinese nationalism and 700 million people. It was roughly analogous to America's experience in Vietnam on a much grander scale.
Typical of what was occurring throughout China was the incident between Chinese and Japanese troops at the Marco Polo Bridge near Peking. It was July 7, 1937. Military commanders on both sides had worked out a local settlement, and in the past, this would have been sufficient.
The Chinese government in Nanking had had so many of these settlements, which had always ended up with some further small aggrandizement of Japanese territory or controls or privileges. But they said they'd had enough of that. They wanted an overall settlement with the Japanese. And they demanded something more basic, and then the Japanese replied the same way, and they dug their heels in. First thing you knew, they were at war with each other. It was an accident. Neither side wanted the war.
Fighting soon spread to Shanghai. The Chinese initially attacked the city, and Japanese troops counterattacked, convinced they could win a quick victory and dictate the peace terms. American reaction was anti-Japanese.
Without a declaration of war, and without warning or justification of any kind, civilians, including vast numbers of women and children, are being ruthlessly murdered with bombs from the air.
The devastating assault raged on for 3 months. Although the United States remained neutral, the American press did not. Life magazine, which featured pictures of Japanese atrocities, was sympathetic to China. Its publisher, Henry Luce, had grown up in China, the son of a Presbyterian missionary. Life boasted that this famous picture of a crying baby amidst the bombed-out ruins of Shanghai was seen by 136 million people. Japanese aggression was also condemned by President Roosevelt.
Nations are fomenting and taking sides in civil warfare in nations that have never done them any harm. Nations claiming freedom for themselves do not deny it to others. America hates war. America. America hopes for peace. Therefore, America actively engages in the search for peace.
In spite of FDR's vehemence, Japanese troops pushed deeper into China. The presence of American troops was strictly for show. The United States maintained a contingent of U.S. Marines to protect Americans on the mainland. Navy gunboats like the USS Panay patrolled the Yangtze River. Duty on board the Panay was coveted by Navy men. Their assignment was simple, to protect American commercial interests along the river. Foreign military advisors were frustrated at the disunity of the Chinese army. American military attaché Colonel Joseph Stilwell felt that Chiang was just another not very competent warlord. Nevertheless, Stilwell helped train Chiang's army while retired Air Corps officer Claire Chennault tried to create a Chinese Air Force. General and Madame Chiang Kai-shek had strong American ties. They bought an armada of American and Italian planes, but new aircraft were slow in coming because of American neutrality. The planes were being held up in California. Chennault's new Curtiss Hawk had more firepower than Japanese planes, but was not as maneuverable. He later convinced Chiang to hire American pilots who became the Flying Tigers. In early December, the Japanese launched their major assault on Nanking, the capital of China. Japanese bombers devastated the city. Japan demanded that China recognize her puppet state in Manchuria, end all anti-Japanese activities, and form a common front against communism. As both governments haggled, Nanking civilians were the ones to suffer the most. General Chiang Kai-shek refused the Japanese terms and evacuated the city for Hankow. Chiang was reluctant to commit his army to almost sure defeat. Knowing he would have to fight Mao Zedong and the communists, he abandoned Nanking to the Japanese. On Sunday, December 12th, Japanese troops engaged in an appalling orgy of destruction. Historians would later call the siege the Rape of Nanking. An estimated 20,000 women in Nanking were raped by Japanese soldiers. And more than 200,000 men, at least a quarter of them civilians, were killed. A third of the city was destroyed by fire. In one night alone, 6,000 Chinese prisoners were executed. Much of the world was shocked at the wanton slaughter.
Death comes from the clear blue sky, just as it has come to thousands of our innocent people throughout the length and breadth of our land. This is in violation of all treaties and human rights. If you wish to avoid the calamities that are befalling China now, and the killing and mutilation of your loved ones, boycott Japanese goods until the Japanese military have left our soil and until they have realized that no nation could carry on such wanton destruction and yet retain the respect of the world.
As the Japanese bombed Nanking, the American gunboat USS Panay lay at anchor in the Yangtze River. The Panay mission was to evacuate Americans from the city. Its crew had been taking aboard staff from the U.S. Embassy, foreign correspondents, photographers, and American businessmen. Suddenly, Japanese planes appeared, heading directly for the well-marked gunboat. As the sailors tried to hold off the attacking aircraft, the captain ordered the ship abandoned. Panay took a direct hit on her bow and a second near the engine room. The planes came back for a second and third assault. Two American sailors and one civilian died. 54 were wounded. The Japanese also destroyed three Standard Oil tankers anchored nearby. One of the most moving reports of the incident came from a foreign correspondent, Italian journalist Luigi Barzini, who tried to comfort his mortally wounded colleague, Sandro Sandri. Barzini later described the attack this way. We were counting off the seconds of our lives with a strange inner rebellion, with disgust for our futile end. There was surely some sort of misunderstanding. It seemed incredible. We did not want to believe it. It was on Christmas Eve that the Japanese apology was delivered.
I am very sorry to receive the reports that the American gunboat Panay has been bombed and sunk by Japanese naval airplanes in the Yangtze River above Nankin. It was a great mistake. The Japanese government and people wish to express their sincerest and profoundest regrets to the American government and people on account of this deplorable incident.
The Panay incident heightened the conflict between the Japanese military and the civilian government. The attack was obviously intentional. Japanese activists, young military commanders in the field, wanted to get something started. But a confrontation with the United States was the last thing the Japanese government wanted at the time. It had its hands full with China. And certainly the United States was in no mood to go to war with Japan at the time. Both sides tried to prevent the incident from blowing up, and the Japanese backed down the last time before Pearl Harbor. At this time, a deep policy split in the U.S. State Department surfaced. The United States had been unwilling to take a very active stand against Japanese aggression. Secretary of State Cordell Hull resorted to a policy of moral indignation.
The American statesmen as a whole did not understand Japan or other Asian nations, I do not think. To the extent that there are very few Japan experts in the government, very few Asia experts in the government.
Ambassador Joseph Grew wanted to exploit the rift between moderates and extremists in Japan, but the State Department largely ignored its man in the field. Asian policy was influenced by the chief of the Far Eastern Division, the powerful Stanley Hornbeck, who insisted on supporting China and advocated a hard line against Japan. In 1938, the Japanese government proclaimed its new order in Asia, a policy to totally subjugate China.
The new Asian order is a very important concept, I think, to try to understand Japan's foreign policy in the 1930s. Now, part of this is a cover for Japan's expansionism. They first go into Manchuria, they conquer China, and then they say they have done it because they would like to establish a new Asian order, quite often it's simply rhetoric. A propaganda gimmick to try to sell their more expansionist conquests to the rest of the world and to the Japanese people.
A strong army was vital to the new order. The government appealed to the patriotism of the Japanese people. As draftees began their training, militarists disguised their motives as a kind of Monroe Doctrine for Asia. Enlistment became part of a sacred mission, but a powerful military was only part of the new order.
Secondly, I think the question is one of the ability of Japan or Asia to become entirely independent of the West. When the Japanese talk about a new order, they still continue to trade with the United States. They enter into an alliance with Germany. In other words, so much of Japan's action is Western oriented.
In June 1940, after the fall of France, the Japanese army moved into northern Indochina. The war in Europe encouraged Japan to establish a bridgehead in Vietnam and use it as a springboard to seize oil and raw materials from the now vulnerable colonies of the British, the French, and the Dutch.
after the collapse of France, it made it easy for the Japanese to take over northern French Indochina and cut off the last rail link from the outside world into China. It was another effort to try to strangle the Chinese and make them give up in their war. And we took certain actions against that preparatory. We denounced the commercial treaty and did some things of that sort, showing that we were finally going to do something more than just shake our finger and talk about it. We were going to act.
In September 1940, the United States imposed a complete embargo on exports to Japan of all grades of iron and scrap steel. Secretary of State Hull finally realized that his Asian policy had been a kind of appeasement. The United States also cut off shipments of aviation fuel to Japan. The day after the American embargo, Japan joined forces with Germany and Italy and signed the Tripartite Pact. Japanese Foreign Minister Matsuoka paraded triumphantly in Berlin, representing the most militant Japanese government to date. The Tripartite Pact required Germany, Italy, and Japan to defend each other if attacked. Suddenly, the European crisis had merged with the Far Eastern crisis.
It's impossible to point to one incident and say this was the turning point, this triggered war. Certainly, American policy toward Japan in the 1920s, our immigration policies, our attempts to limit Japan's navy, all that contributed and set some forces in motion. It was diplomat historian George Kennan who observed that in the fabric of human events, one thing leads to another. Every mistake is, in a sense, the product of all the mistakes that have gone before it, from which fact it derives a sort of cosmic forgiveness. And at the same time, every mistake, in a sense, is the determinant of all the mistakes of the future, from which it derives a sort of cosmic unforgivableness. Our action in the field of foreign policy, he said, is cumulative. It merges with a swelling stream of other human happenings, and we cannot trace its effect with any exactness once it has entered the fluid substance of history. Nowhere was this more true than with American-Japanese relations prior to the Second World War. The point at which tragedy overtook human frailty is a hazy blur.
In the fall of 1940, America quietly went about raising an army. September, the president had signed the Selective Service Act. The Germany-Italy-Japan Axis alliance only stiffened American resolve. The president's new Secretary of War, Henry Stimson, drew the first number, and the country waited anxiously.
The first number drawn by the Secretary of War is serial number 158.
Our present program will train 800,000 additional men this coming year. It is a program, obviously, of defensive preparation, and of defensive preparation only.
As the Japanese were drawn more deeply into the vortex of China, neither Japan nor the United States could foresee that the future ruler of China was biding his time, waiting patiently in the mountains of northern China, raising his own army. Mao Zedong, the leader of the Chinese Communists, used the threat of Japan to rally China's enormous peasant population. The years of World War II would provide him the opportunity for indoctrination that he might not otherwise have had, though the seeds of revolution were sown.